as far as like them helping to manifest things in your life, uh-huh. like if you wanted uh-huh. something,
yes.
What would be the approach? And, you know, that kind of brings you brought up prayer too.
Yeah.
That was one of my questions. You know, I've, you know, grown up Christian and then went through the phase of the Bible's bad and then went through
sure.
a phase of trying to understand it. And
yeah.
the whole concept of prayer to me is kind of, I'm like, I don't know how to do it anymore. 'Cause it's like, you know, who am I praying to? Or, you know, I'm just very confused on the whole thing. So I haven't done it. You know?
Okay. So the process of prayer is probably one of the most accurate services that the Christian church actually could not distort too much. The distortion is where the direction of the prayer goes.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay? Now, it's not even bad to pray to God or to Jesus or any particular individual like that, because they still exist. Okay? You will still get an effective result. All right? The only point that is of a greater issue is that you're actually, when you move out of Christianity in your own way, it means that you're actually ready for the next level of integrating exactly what God is, as in getting a little bit more succinct. Okay? And the number one distortion that came from Christianity was in the identification of God on the outside versus God on the inside.
Yeah.
Now, they say God is in everybody and everything, but you're not God. They basically
yeah.
did not know how to absolve the concept of the ego causing all sorts of problems, and they didn't want to say God was causing the problems. But you know what? God was causing the problems. They just called it, you know, the devil or something. The devil's the one that caused the problems. The fallen angel.
Yeah.
All this. Now, it's not entirely untrue. There's lots of energy that, you know, that fallen angels have been given in many circumstances, but for the greater part, prayer is done for yourself. Christianity did not is almost like anti-selfish concepts, right?
Mm-hmm.
But the truth is, since God primordially is you, and that you are at the center of creation of all physical things. Imagine that you're sort of like the middle of the Big Bang, okay, energy-wise. You're a humming light that attracts all experiences into existence and coalesces experiences, much like the formation of the solar system and the planets coalesced, okay, gravitationally into more and more succinct experiences. All right? The sun did that and created the planets, created Earth too.
Mm-hmm.
And Earth did it so that life can occur. So in another way, it formed the building blocks in which things like plants, insects, and animals, and humans could exist. You're doing the same thing. You're coalescing forms of consciousness that appear not to be physical at first into having a physical experience or observable experience. And you gain joy through the observation of that fact. Many people say, well, I want to create, but I need proof first. That's like saying to the sun, you know what? Before you can create an earth, you need to see what an earth looks like. Or you need to already be convinced that the earth already exists. No, it comes from the broader into the more denser existence. Quite literally, your focus, if you can see the energy of what your eyes do, the way the crystals do, your eyes are like Superman lasers, okay? Mm. And quite literally, you're pouring your awareness into whatever you're focusing on and vice versa. Whatever you're focusing on reflects into your eyes. So you both see and you're creating just by looking at things. Now, when you think about what you're looking about and what you're looking at, that escalates the process. That escalates the connection. Okay? So as you focus on things that are just in your head and you're not, you know, with your eyes closed or whatever, that's like putting life into that experience coming into play. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
Now what we have is a protective mechanism, which is basically the brain, containing the ego and the body and the subconscious and all this, in many ways. We have the brain has physical limits.
Weird.
Okay.
The brain has physical limits, sorry.
Brain has physical limits. And so in order to transcend the buffer, this gets a bit complicated, but you know, you can listen to this afterwards. In order to transcend the buffer that prevents you from creating instantly, we have what's called the buffer of time, which is also the concept of illusion. Time creates separation because there's the before, the now, and the future, right?
Yeah.
But the illusion is in this idea that things are separate when they're not. You know, this idea that I just walked 5 feet across the room? Well, the idea is that I didn't exist on the other side of the room before I decided to go there. But the truth is, you merged with the reality in which you're standing over there. You think that you're walking, right, as a point of consciousness. You're going from place to place, but really, place to place is coming to you. You move your feet, and the earth moves underneath you. It's a bit freaky to think about it that way, right? It seems like the opposite of how it works.
Yeah, yeah.
But your mind wants certain things to be consistent in a way that it can factor. Okay? That's why this whole reality that's very believable. It's because we have cut ourselves off from the full conscious awareness of divinity. Okay? Because of that, we can give a lot of focus without saying, I don't need to be focusing on this. You got like a saber-toothed tiger, you know, chasing you back in the caveman days. That was important. And you focused on that. You gave that a lot of attention. You developed a lot of survival skills as a human. And so it became very literal. Now, I want to explain to you, you're familiar with Arcturians?
Yes.
You've heard that before? Well, Arcturians, yes. They love the barbarian age. Okay? There's lots of planets where they go and they live the barbarian age, like Conan, but with dragons and magic and all sorts of Dungeons and Dragons-like things, swords and things, right? They love that because that is the most visceral that they can have a physical experience most of the time. Right? So they love things like combat, too. They love things like contrast. They love things like, you know, great Star Wars kinds of things. But fundamentally, that's really just the children, the childlike souls of the Arcturians. They're just trying to figure out what's worth enjoying, you know? The idea of having a good meal after a day of working in the fields is like, it's a good feeling. The idea of cutting somebody's head off to save your family is a good feeling.
Yeah.
Okay? So contextually in that place, they do that. But the thing is, it's like they're facing fears constantly. One of the things that they always have is they can decide to tap out, just like in a wrestling match. Say, I'm tapping out.
Yeah.
Take me off the planet or wake me up. And usually you create the conditions before you go and incarnate onto a planet, or basically, a lot of times they don't incarnate. They actually just go through a memory wipe and they drop down on the planet.
Huh.
Right?
Yeah.
Some of them have been called prison planets because, you know, there's like these games that they play in terms of survival of the fittest and, you know, hierarchies and things. They play them, but they play them in small contexts. Okay? They can always tap out. And when they die, they don't really die. They always have, like, what might be an equivalent of, like, a clone of themselves, of what they were before they dropped in on the planet. But all their memories go with them. Okay? Works a little differently here. Here, we essentially do not get to see what's off the planet. We don't get to see what happens when we kick the bucket. Because that would prevent the literal density of how much energy is being poured into everything here. The more time we have a lot of people here putting attention into stuff, the more stuff is becoming real.
Yeah.
Does that make sense? The more real things get, the more eyes and the more feelings and the more people there are creating stuff. So this world is like Disneyland to groups like the Pleiadians and the Arcturians and all this. Like, when they come here, there's, like, way too much going on. Way too much.
I bet.
okay?
A lot of creators.
Yeah, you've seen, like, maybe a movie or a story where, like, someone from Africa, like, you know, shows up in New York City or something. They're like, oh, my God.
Oh, yeah.
No. Sensory overload. Yeah. Basically
That'd
what it's
that.
Like. Okay? It's also why they're very interested in Earth and people here. Because the people here, even if you think you've had a crappy life, if you've lived more than 7 months, apparently it's 7 months is like where most people from off planet would probably tap out in this situation.
Hmm.
And many people from off planet, I'm being told, this is just shared to me by the Pleiadians, lots of Pleiadians have come here and chosen that human form so that they don't look weird, and they've tapped out on the average at around 7 months. After 7 months, they actually become human and they forget their Pleiadian.
Oh, wow. Huh.
Okay? Like, there's so much going on here. Everything that they knew from the life from before is fairly irrelevant. So irrelevant that they forget. Some actually go through the process of being convinced they're not Pleiadian anymore. Because that's what happens. They come and pick them up. And they say, hey, time to go. Like, what the hell are you doing? Who are you?
Crazy.
Yeah. Okay.
Wow.
So it's, you know, even the starseeds, they say they want to wake up. But, you know, after 7 months, if you're not still trying, you'll probably go back to, you know, just live a human life. The best potential
yeah.
that you can. You know?
Yeah.
So, in many ways, you know what's going on now. You understand that those that were from off-planet had to be born here. They weren't allowed to just show up because otherwise they would probably die real quick. Okay? They're basically of no help unless they come and meet the criteria where they insert a part of their soul into the human experience, and they make a hell of a lot of arrangements with guides and their higher self so that they can live out the plan of being a human that is part of the purpose of helping humans ascend to another level, which is basically taking so much control out of everything needing to be so thick energetically. And return to what the other societies consider a more dreamlike experience, a lot more flexible, a lot less intensity.
Yeah.
Because the intensity prevents creation in many ways. Fear prevents you from going forward. Right? The fear is really just the unknown. So I'm not ready for that. Well, if you had a vaster skill set, you would be ready for that, and you can keep going. So essentially what's happened is that the human experiment imploded on itself. Okay? Literally, the idea of becoming a prison planet is all that it was ever going to get to become. More limits based upon more limits and based upon more limits.
Yeah.
That has shifted. It's taken a long time. We're not talking just since 2012. Long before that. Like 60, 70 years. Of concentrated effort on moving towards what people are calling the positive timeline. Okay? And that's where the potential is now in favor of expansion versus continual contraction. Okay?